Simon & Schuster Audio presents Rap Capital, An Atlanta Story by Joe Coscarelli, read by Landon Woodson.
Introduction. Dominique Jones was never expecting a revolution. He wasn't even supposed to be a rapper, let alone an activist. But in Atlanta, Georgia, in the summer of 2020, the man known as Lil Baby wasn't left with much of a choice. Early that June, as he marched down Mitchell Street, west of downtown, Baby raised his fist in the air, mirroring the more seasoned protesters, and he joined them in their chants of "No justice, no peace." Skinny and loping, the rapper was discreet as could be, save for the cameras following his every step. Dressed in a plain black t-shirt and matching snapback, no chains, and a bulbous white medical mask obscuring most of his newly famous face. "This is what matters," Lil Baby leaned over and told his guide for the day, an ambitious local city councilman. About an hour in, when a white business owner on the route passed out bottles of water to the group, Baby handed him $500. Days after the protest, the Southwest Atlanta native, only 3 years into an unlikely music career, would see his biggest album yet hit number one on the Billboard chart for a second time. And in the weeks that followed, a third, fourth, and fifth. But even as a millionaire on the rise, Lil Baby wasn't that far removed from his days at the mercy of white corrections officers, or the cops who had thrown him into a room with no cameras to remind him who was in charge. The year prior to the demonstrations, Baby, already a budding star, had been removed from a sports car in evening traffic and pushed face first into the Atlanta pavement to be handcuffed for speeding. So as another summer of Black Lives Matter uprisings took shape around the country, the urgent response to months, years, decades, centuries of consequence-less killings of Black people, Ahmaud Arbery, Breonna Taylor, and George Floyd Jr. recently among them, Baby felt personally obligated to take to the streets of his hometown during the global COVID-19 pandemic. He needed to confront what had long been his reality, especially before rap helped rescue him from a chaotic world of guns and drug dealing that had already sent him to prison once. Still, this wasn't his comfort zone. Generally reserved and content to keep his head down, Baby did not consider himself a role model or a particularly political person. When it came to hip-hop, he hadn't exactly grown up on Public Enemy or N.W.A. He was 25. Even the local philosopher gods and Goody Mob and Outkast were a bit before his time. He didn't much look up to artists anyway. "Money is the only fucking option," went the thesis statement of his first ever single. Yet within a year after the protests, Lil Baby would be at the White House with George Floyd's family, meeting with Joe Biden, Kamala Harris, and Nancy Pelosi about policing and criminal justice reform. Because whether he'd planned it or not, Baby had become a leader, the culmination of nearly three decades of Atlanta rap, and specifically the Southern subgenre known as trap music, which revolved around the blaring son of the drug trade, from Raheem the Dream, MC Shy D and Kilo Ali, through Gucci Mane, T.I. and Young Jeezy, not to mention untold other innovators, both recognized and disregarded along the way. Their work grew from struggle, from racism, from pain, from impossibility, and it worked on two crucial levels: for those who felt it, lived it, needed it, and for those who wanted to dabble in the ups and downs, if only from afar. Their experiences, Baby's experience, growing up rough in the city of Atlanta, had somehow become national youth culture, their music the dominant lens through which a neglected humanity was partially understood, all while serving as America's principal artistic illustration of both crushing poverty and absurd, unexpected wealth. A convicted felon raised by a single mother on government assistance, Baby detailed in his jittery music just how amazing and awful it could feel simultaneously to make it out of such insurmountable circumstances. His very existence was a political statement. But his music up to then, wordy, rich, wrenching, and bass-heavy, was, according to his fans, the perfect soundtrack for reckless driving or basketball highlight montages, not protests. Baby's motivational street anthem sometimes sounded like they were being played in fast forward, like he had too many things to say at once, and they had been filled lately with jabbing boasts about wearing so much diamond jewelry that it all tangled together, about buying floor seats at Madison Square Garden and standing up to cheer, not because he cared about the game, but just to show off his wares. More than anything else, Baby's music was autobiographical, full of details that may have felt insignificant to anyone outside of his family or closest friends, allusions to illicit business on Spark Street, near-miss shootouts, the hustlers who helped him, and the women who wanted to. This was the stuff, like the songs of his Atlanta forebears, that was so potent, so original, so honest, well-stylized and alluringly transgressive, that it had become a worldwide touchstone, in spite of being grounded in discrete places and plights that were otherwise often ignored. Like his predecessors, Lil Baby blended an oral tradition of neighborhood dope boy mythology with melodic, ominous, synth and 808-driven beats to create a constantly evolving sound that, in a wholly unexpected development given its serrated edges, had ended up a go-to mode for much of music, white or black, by the late 2010s. Lady Gaga, Beyoncé, Miley Cyrus, and Ariana Grande mined trap's rhythms and its slang. Super Bowl commercials tapped its talent, and suburban teenagers everywhere adhered to its slick and loud designer dress code. Like the essence of jazz, rock, disco, techno, and so on, the source code was always black. But the applications were widespread and only sometimes came with acknowledgement. Trap was being borrowed, sampled, looted, diluted, hoarded, disparaged, and hailed all at once. Years after the statement had already become a fact, a t-shirt announcing "Atlanta influences everything" became a defiant, wearable meme. But as the culture reporter and critic Rodney Carmichael wrote in 2016, to be an ATLian means being simultaneously fetishized and stigmatized in much the same way America outwardly loves black culture, but inwardly loathes black life. Lil Baby knew this dichotomy in his bones as he marched on that summer day. In fact, he had already recorded a new song to that effect, inspired by the unmistakable moment he was living through. What most who saw Baby protesting didn't know at first was that his participation was also doubling as research and as a music video shoot for the biggest swerve in his brief career so far. At midnight on June 12, 2020, Lil Baby released The Bigger Picture. Immediately hailed as an essential Black Lives Matter protest anthem, and with the promise that its proceeds would support the movement, the song was tidy and timely on the surface. But it was most striking upon closer listen in its stream of consciousness ambivalence, its inability to stay simple. "It's bigger than black and white," Baby rapped. "It's a problem with the whole way of life." Across three unwieldy verses, Baby declined to sublimate the uncouth complexities of his own experiences, celebrating a new car and an old friend who just beat a murder charge before declaring, "I find it crazy the police shoot you and know that you dead, but still tell you to freeze." This was the whole story, still unfolding, not a neat narrative. "I can't lie like I don't rap about killing and dope, but I'm telling my youngins to vote," he rattled off, his unpredictable candor making his bursts of compassion and critique land harder. In the same song, Baby refused to condemn all cops, encouraged black gun ownership out of necessity, vowed to never testify in court, and admitted to running at the first flash of blue lights. He sounded exhausted and angry and alive. Eventually, The Bigger Picture would be streamed hundreds of millions of times, reaching number 3 on the Billboard singles chart and earning Baby 2 Grammy nominations, plus a double platinum plaque. But first, the night after the song's release, it happened again, as Baby must have known that it would. This time, it was at home. Outside of a Wendy's in South Atlanta, Rayshard Brooks, an unarmed 27-year-old black father of four, spent more than 30 minutes speaking calmly with two white police officers.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.